The life of David is cataloged in the Old Testament in the books of 1 and 2 Samuel. We've been going through those books for a long time at Dinner Church. Feels like we've been going through 1 and 2 Samuel for about 50 weeks. Been a long time, but it's been really good. And we're getting right near the end. We're now at the end of 2 Samuel chapter 19. And we see a guy named Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth. Add that one again to your baby name list. I know we're creating one with the Old Testament. Mephibosheth. Name your daughter. Well, it's a guy name. So you name your son Mephibosheth. And Mephibosheth is, if you recall from like 10 chapters back, he is the last living descendant of King Saul, who was king before David. So this is one of Saul's last relatives. And when King David fled the city of Jerusalem from Absalom, Mephibosheth did not go with him. But if you recall, Mephibosheth is disabled. He's lame in both legs, okay? So he stayed behind, but, I mean, how could he leave? So he's now coming to King David to say, I'm sorry I didn't go with you, but here's what's happening. Mephibosheth, this whole time that David's been gone, he doesn't eat, he doesn't bathe, he doesn't shave. He's doing this to show that he's been with David spiritually. He's been worrying about him the whole time that he's been gone. This is a way of Mephibosheth to show his loyalty to David. He says, I was with you even though I couldn't go. Okay? I was with you even though I couldn't go. We also see a guy named Barzillai. Okay, you can add that one to your baby name list as well. Barzillai? Wow. He's a rich guy who lived in Manahim. And he supported David when David had ran from Absalom to Manahim. Mephibosheth.
You just said it like four times.
I know, right? Now I can't get it. Mephibosheth. Chelsea cannot say that name at all, so I'm doing pretty good up here. Hopefully she doesn't listen to this recording. All of our sermons are recorded on Facebook as well. I will post this, but hopefully she doesn't listen to it, because I didn't mention that she doesn't know how to pronounce Mephibosheth. And I've tried to teach her how to say it. I don't know why. Why am I teaching her how to say this obscure name in the Bible? I don't know. Because I'm bored. And so I'm like, come on, sweetie, you can get it. Mephibosheth. And we'll be sitting there and she'll get Mephibosheth. Like, you'll get it, Mephibosheth. You'll get it, it's okay. But Mephibosheth has not washed his clothes or shaved or cared for his appearance. But if you recall, he was disabled as well. And like I said, this is how he shows his allegiance to King David. And for us, our first application today, we want to show our allegiance to God through Jesus Christ in many ways. And similarly, Mephibosheth shows his allegiance to David by not shaving, not showering. He's almost fasting while he's away, right? Showing his concern and his commitment to the cause of David. And I think to myself, how does this relate to us at Dinner Church today in 2023? Many of us here have disabilities, have physical health problems, have mental health problems, have addictions. And we can't do everything that other people do, right? And that's the same with Mephibosheth. He can't do everything other people do. But he shows his commitment in other ways. So you can show your commitment in other ways that you might not fully realize. Say, well, I walk with a cane. I can't get around that. Well, I can't make a lot of money. But there are other ways you can serve God by like showing up here. By prayer. You show your commitment to God in different ways, unique ways. You know, a lot of people volunteer here. They don't have loads of money to give to God's kingdom, but they come here and they volunteer. So, in your life, find the unique ways that you can serve God. Like me, I'm pretty good with social media, with like Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest. So I use that talent to spread God's word that way. I'm always posting stuff online about the Bible, about Jesus, about salvation. About what we do with the Salvation Army. I'm trying to use my talent that God's given me to spread his word. And it may be that you're an artist or a poet or an architect. You can use your talents for God's kingdom, Sarah. You really can. You've got a talent you can use too.
Laughter is a big, good medicine. I like funny stuff, make people laugh.
Amen. See, that's good too. God likes laughter. He wants people to laugh and smile, so we can use those talents to help people. And Mephibosheth, with that disability, he's got to do it, and he's got to show his commitment in unique ways. Okay, that's our first point today. Show your commitment in unique ways. Okay? Let's keep going, though. Second point is, David shows grace to Mephibosheth. Did he say, you didn't come with me? Well, I don't like you anymore. No. David accepts him back as a friend, as a confidant. He says, I know you can't serve in certain ways, but I respect that you're still with me in your heart. And God also does that too, you know. He accepts our unique forms of worship, even if it's not quite what most people do. He will accept what we offer, even if it's not much. Like the widow, right? The widow who puts her last two coins in, that's all she's got. She doesn't have billions of dollars to throw in the plate. She got a few coins. And Jesus looks at her and says, she's given more than everyone else in here. Because she gave from her lack. That's all she had, and she gave it. So God doesn't always see the things the way we do. We think, well, someone who's rich in the world is like Elon Musk, you know? That's someone who's rich. Jeff Bezos is someone who's rich, right? That's someone who's wealthy or powerful. But for Jesus, he says, listen, it's often the poorest people who are the richest in spirit. They're, you know, someone who has Christ is more rich than the most wealthy atheist. It's interesting. Okay, then at the end of 2 Samuel 19, we see that David is crossing the Jordan River. He's on his way back to Jerusalem. And he's with the tribe of Judah. Judah is his tribe. You know, there's 12 tribes in Israel. Judah is his tribe. Those are his friends, his family. And if you recall, though, last week, Judah did not come to him. He had to go to Judah and say, hey, why aren't you with me during this rebellion? But now Judah has kind of caught on and said, we're going to stay with David now. But then the rest of the tribes of Israel come and meet David at the Jordan River. And the rest of the tribes have joined Absalom in the rebellion. So, what does David do in this situation, you know? He's going to try again to bring unity. He's going to try to bring people together. He could very easily say, like, hey, you fought against me in this war. I don't like you anymore, you know? And like last week we talked about, like, it's hard when someone wrongs us to forgive, isn't it? Someone really hurts us. Yeah, that's tough. But for David, he's trying to keep the nation together. It says in verses 40 through 43, the king passed on to Gilgal, and Kimhon went on with him, that's one of his friends. And all the people of Judah and half the people of Israel passed on with the king. Now all the men of Israel were coming to the king and said to the king, why have our brothers, the men of Judah, stolen you away and brought the king and his household across the Jordan and all of the men of David with him? All the men of Judah answered the men of Israel, because the king is our close relative. Why are you angry over this matter? Have we eaten at all at the king's expense? Has he given us any gifts? And then the men of Israel answered the men of Judah and said, we have 10 shares in the king. Therefore, we also have more claim on David than you. Why then did you treat us with contempt? Were we not the first to advise bringing back our king? But the words of the men of Judah were harsher than the words of the men of Israel. Okay, so you see this back and forth between the 10 tribes and then Judah and Benjamin, who are loyal to David. And what we're seeing is that the splitting of the nation, slowly but surely. And after Solomon, David's son, the nation would split. Israel would split between Samaria and Judah. And that would go on for a long, long time, all the way until Jesus was born. Because if you recall, during the time of Jesus, he lived in Judah, but he also would visit Samaria. That's because the nation was split between Judah and Samaria. And it's all starting right here in 2 Samuel, the divide. So our third point today, avoid harsh words. because the tribe of Judah was harsh with Israel. Have you ever known someone who's pretty harsh? Was it your dad? Was it, okay, for you it was your dad, maybe it was your mom, maybe it was your grandpa or your grandma or a friend, maybe it was your boss at work, someone who's harsh, abrupt, kind of vicious with their mouth. Have you ever experienced that? You almost get lashed by their tongue, right? Ow, ow, stop hitting me, you know? It's intense. And let me tell you, friends, if you can avoid harsh words even when you're upset, you're going to go a long way in life. Because there's been times when I've wanted to be harsh with my employees here at the Salvation Army, and I've had to stop and say, hold on, Justin, is that how you want to treat your people? Harshly? And that doesn't mean you don't correct. You still can correct people, but you do it in love. Now, if you can learn that in your life, even when you're angry, to not be harsh, to be softened, even when you're mad, you're going to go a long way. But if you are harsh, you can divide a family. You can divide a kingdom. And those divisions may never be healed. That's scary. You think about like the Civil War in the United States. I mean, hundreds of thousands of people lost their lives because of this harsh divide that happened. And I worry about our country right now. There's such a division. And the harsh words being thrown between left and right, it's just nonstop. And you only think, where is this going? You know? It's so intense. It's so vicious. I mean, what do you do? How do you prevent a split? I don't know. But I think it starts with softening our words and working toward unity, not division, somehow, while still sticking with our values. We don't want to compromise our values, compromise our beliefs, just become like a kind of wishy-washy. That's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying become a wishy-washy, just say like a yes man to everything. No, that's not what I'm saying. Stick with your guns, your values, but also speak kindly. It's going to go a long way. You can stick with your guns and speak kindly. You can do both. Okay? That's huge. If you learn that, you're going to bring peace in your family and not divisions. But despite all this, all these harsh words, somehow it looks like it's going to be okay. Despite the rebellion of Absalom, David is seeming to bring the nation together. But then you flip to 2 Samuel chapter 20, where a man named Sheba jumps into the situation. Baby name number 3, Sheba. Sheba? I don't know. It's kind of catchy, maybe. Well, I don't know. Kind of sounds, I don't know, like a sheep or something. Sheba. Sheba. It's better than Mephibosheth, I think. It's better. I don't know if it's that much better. Anyway, Sheba is a troublemaker. Uh-oh. Says this in 2 Samuel 20, verses 1 and 2. Now a troublemaker named Sheba happened to be there. He blows his trumpet and shouted, "We have no share in David, no part in Jesse's son. Every man to his tent, Israel." So all the men of Israel deserted David to follow Sheba. Are you kidding me? After all that, they follow this troublemaker? That makes me a little salty. Okay, really? But it says the men of Judah stayed by their king, all the way from Jordan on their journey to Jerusalem. So Judah stays loyal. The rest join Sheba, another troublemaker. So first we had Absalom leading a rebellion. Now we've got Sheba starting a new one. And again, the nation is split between Sheba and David. Apparently, this troublemaker is very influential. He probably comes off pretty well, speaks pretty eloquently. And as they stand by the River Jordan, the tribe of Judah stays loyal to David, and half of Israel leaves with Sheba. Wow. Fourth point today for your life. Stay away from troublemakers. Stay away from troublemakers. Why are you laughing, Stephen?
Stay
away from troublemakers.
It's like people that likes to stir drama.
Exactly.
Talk about people behind
the back. Stay away from those people who cause drama. Yeah. Just don't go near them because they're going to, guess what?
They give you negative.
Yeah, yeah. Get this, okay? Listen to this fact. If they gossip to you, what do you think that they're doing when you're gone? They're gossiping about you. Thank you. Why didn't I figure that out after 30 years? If they're gossiping to you, they're gossiping about you. Come on. Stay away from those people. Okay? Gossip, drama, drama queen, drama king. People who always cause divisions and problems. Avoid those people, plain and simple. And if you notice that in yourself a little bit, it's time to ask God's forgiveness. Lord, I messed up here. I've caused some drama. Stay away from yourself. There you go. Stay away from yourself. No. Ask God's forgiveness, though. Say, Lord, I messed up here. I've caused some drama, some division. Forgive me, Lord. I'm going to do better next time. Make a change in your life. If you're that drama queen, make a change. If you're that drama king, make a change. Say, Lord, I'm not going to do that anymore. Lord, help me. I repent. Because we don't want to end up like Sheba, a rebel. Because a troublemaker, you start to become a gossip. It's like you start down this road of, okay, I'm a gossip now. Okay, now I'm a bit of a drama king. Okay, now I'm a bit of a troublemaker. It's like you keep walking down pretty soon. Now I'm a rebel. It's just getting worse and worse, right? You're walking down this road, and you can always turn around. I'm telling you. God is a God of second chances. You can always turn around, even if you're way down the wrong road. I know it. I was a druggie. You can turn around on that road. I'm telling you, you can. At any point, turn around. God will take you back just like that. Praise God. He's so good. But yeah, we can start down that road. Drama. Troublemaker. Rebel. Let's not become that. Let's not go that way. So David is now back in Jerusalem. Sheba is leading a rebellion. If you remember when Absalom captured Jerusalem, he took David's concubines and he mistreated them in front of the whole nation, if you remember. And David's first act is to make sure those concubines are cared for. But they are left to live as widows the rest of their lives. It says when David returned to his palace in Jerusalem, he took the 10 concubines he had left to take care of the palace and put them in a house under guard. He provided for them, but had no relations with them. They were kept in confinement to the day of their death, living as widows. Point number 5 today, some things you can't take back. Sometimes when something bad happens to you, it will change things forever. It wasn't the concubine's fault that would have been done to them by Absalom, but it couldn't be undone. Sin has consequences. Don't be like Absalom and mistreat someone. Because I'll tell you, I used to bully people when I was in about 6th grade. I imagine some of the things that me and my friend Max said to people stayed with them the rest of their lives. You know that nasty remark that you think of every once in a while that someone said to you? I can remember times that I was bullied to this day. Isn't that gross? That's gross. So I don't want to leave anyone with that the rest of their life. But sometimes when you say something or you do something, it can't be unsaid. It can't be undone. They're going to live with that the rest of their lives. So, like the book of Proverbs says, even a fool, if he doesn't talk, seems wise. So sometimes I just got to zip my mouth and shut up. Shut your mouth. It's okay. Just be quiet sometimes. Sometimes I got to tell him, Justin, don't say anything. It's okay. Just don't talk. It'll be okay. Because sometimes they'll stay with, like we said, it'll stay with them their whole lives, what you said to them. I don't want to leave that on someone's heart, someone's life. There were women that I mistreated when I was before a Christian. You know what someone I used, that's going to stay with them the rest of their life, I think. It may repeat in their mind, I'm garbage because this guy mistreated me, treated me like I was nothing. That's going to repeat in her mind the rest of her life. God forbid, though. And Lord, have mercy, you know. These people that I mistreated and that we have all mistreated. I know I'm not the only one here who has mistreated a man or woman in their life. God, may it be so that they do not live with that the rest of their lives. That they find healing too, like we found healing, you know. Amen? Yeah. Next, in verse 4, David sends Amasa, the leader of his troops, to gather the armies of the tribe of Judah to prepare to counter Sheba's rebellion. This is now the second rebellion that David is dealing with. And I'm thinking to myself, man, this is stressful. Man, have you ever had a really stressful time in your life where you're like, okay, I just dealt with this and now this happened. Okay, and I just dealt with this and now this also has happened. It's just nonstop.
Yes.
Like there's like 3, 4, 5 things all at the same time and you're like, I am stressed out and I can't deal with it anymore. And then another thing happens. You're like, whoa, I don't know what to do. And you start to go a little PTSD, you know, like, I can't do this, you know. It's hard. That's what I feel like is going on with David right here. It's just one thing after another, and he can't deal with it. Yet somehow he has to. And in those times in your life, trust God and don't give up. And I know that sounds, it sounds like, shut up, Pastor. Like, I don't want to hear that right now, you know? Like, trust God? I don't want to hear that. Okay, then just hear this. Don't give up. You know, don't give up. We may not always want to hear trust God, because we already know that. I know that. I know I need to trust God. But don't give up, too. Okay? Hold on. Because like the song, right? The Danny Gokey song. The bright sunshine on the other side of the darkest night. Maybe it comes. You can't see it, but you got to believe it, that it's coming. Good things are coming. Even though right now it seems like, you know, sometimes it feels like I'm in the wreck of the Titanic and it's over, you know, and I'm going down with the ship. I'm playing with the violinist on the Titanic, you know, nearer my God to thee, you know, I'm going down with the ship. Sometimes it feels that way, but no, if we can see the future, I'm about to be rescued. But I think we often get stuck in, I'm doomed. I know I do. Things aren't going to get better. It's a lie. It's not true. Things are going to get better. And God is with me. Okay? And here we see David's troops go after Sheba. Led by Joab. Supposed to be led by Amasa. But Joab goes and kills Amasa, which is crazy. Stabs him when he's pretending to hug him because he wants revenge because Amasa got his job. This is again messed up. Point number 6 today relates to that. In verse 9, Joab said to Amasa, how are you, my brother? And then Joab took Amasa by the beard with his right hand to kiss him. He's like, oh, buddy, come here. I love you. You're my best friend. In those ancient times, it was normal for someone to, you know, kiss each other on the cheek, kind of like almost like Italians, you know, kind of. But then as he's hugging him, Joab plunges a dagger into his belly, and it says his intestines spilled out on the ground. I read that. I'm like, dang, that's intense. Intestines spilled out? Woo! Better all done eating. Okay. Intestines spilled out on the ground. And Amasa just died right there. I thought to myself, man, what a jerk. Pretending to be this guy's buddy and then stabs him. So point number 6, be cautious of the friendly enemy. Okay? Or as they say, frenemy. Frenemy. Friendly enemy. Frenemy. Yeah? Amasa's got Joab's job, and Joab wanted revenge. Amasa wasn't cautious. If I was Amasa, I'd be like, yeah, you just stay over there. I know I got your job right now, and you're probably not happy. Oh, you're my buddy? Yeah, just stay over there. You'd be my buddy about 10 feet away. Okay? But he doesn't. He kind of falls for it. We got to be wise, because we all have friends who are actually enemies. I'm sure many of you do here have people in your lives who are not necessarily there as your friend. They may play the friend, but they're actually an enemy.
They're just a hypocrite.
Yeah, it's a hypocrite. Be careful of that person. Keep them at a distance. Don't let them too close. Don't give them your secrets. Because guess what? They're probably going to try to use that stuff against you. Be cautious of the frenemy. All right? Good. So here's what happens next. He flees to the city of Abel Beth Makkah. Joab goes after him with the army of Judah. They siege the city. In verses 15 through 17, they build a siege ramp up the city, and they are fighting against its fortifications. But then a wise woman comes to the wall, a wise woman. And she says to Joab, "Why are you attacking our city? We're the same as you. We're the same nation." And Joab says, "Because Sheba is hiding there, this rebel." So Joab is attacking the city. Sheba is hiding there. The wise woman is trying to prevent the destruction of the city. And the wise woman says, "Hey, stop attacking us and we'll deal with Sheba ourselves." That brings us to point number 7 tonight. Be like the wise woman. And she, you know what she does? She asks to speak to the one in charge. Interesting. And we can do that with God in Jesus Christ. When I got a problem in my life, friends, in the past, my first reaction was, "Okay, I'm going to worry about this. Oh, I'm so worried. Oh, I'm so stressed up. Oh, I'm so stressed out right now. Ah! Can anyone relate? Gosh, I'm so stressed out. Gosh, is that helpful?" No! That's not helpful. Why did I do that for all those years from now? Gosh, I better worry about this. I better worry. Why? Why am I worried? This is so stupid. Is this helpful? Sitting there? Oh, I'm so worried. Oh, what if this happens? Oh, well, what would be, you know, be even worse? That happened.
I think several of us have been there.
Yeah. Okay, you've been there. I think all of us have probably been there. Oh, I'm going to worry about it. Stop worrying about it and pray about it. You, in this situation, you're going to be like a carrot at the register. "I'd like to speak to the manager now." Okay? You now have permission to be a Karen in this situation. "I want to speak to the manager." Be polite, though. "I'm going to speak to God. Heavenly Father, I don't know what to do about this situation. I'm worried, but I'm giving you my worry. I'm giving you my fear. I'm putting it in your court, God. It's on you now. It's not on me. In Jesus' name, amen." You pray. You bring it to the manager. You bring it to the Father. And you put it in his hand. Instead of worrying, "Oh, I'm so worried," you say, "No, I'm going to take it to prayer to God." If you can train yourself to do that, man, you're gonna succeed in life. Instead, every time you start worrying, you say, "Wait a minute, I remember what the pastor said. I need to take it to God. Instead of just sitting here stressing, just pointless, I'm going to take it to God in prayer. And say, God, help me. I don't know what to do in this situation. Help me." Now, if you can train your mind to do that, your mind does not naturally do that. So you're going to need to train your mind to do that. Your mind does not naturally say, "I'm going to pray about it." Your mind says, "I'm going to worry about it and stress myself out until I make myself sick." You've got to train your mind to say, "No, I'm not going to worry. I'm going to pray. I'm going to trust God. I'm going to pray and pray and pray. And then God is going to get me through this." But you got to train your mind is not naturally going to do that. You got to train your mind to do that. I've started to do that. What I stress about is like politics, world stuff, economics, big questions, big issues. And lately, as I read the news and stress out, I say, "Hold on, pray right now. Oh, this happened in the laws of Michigan. Pray. This is going on the ballot. Pray. This is going on in the culture. Pray." I train myself to pray. And that takes it off of me and puts it onto him. And guess what? God can deal with that. I can't. God can. Okay. Just like the wise woman who asked to speak to the manager, he asked to speak to Joab and says, "Let's figure this out." So you know what happens? The wise woman gathers the leaders of the city and they capture Sheba and they kill Sheba. And they toss his head over the wall. You know, I like the Old Testament, but it's always so bloody. I just, so intense. In any case, last point today. Understand that for the end of a rebel is death. Are you a rebel today? Rebels are not tolerated in God's kingdom. They end like Sheba. Don't be like Sheba, who rebelled against King David. If you're a rebel against God right now, if you need to change positions in this battlefield, I want to invite you to do it right now. Okay? Something C.S. Lewis said about becoming a Christian is we put down our weapons of rebellion and we surrender. And we join God's side. We leave the rebel side with Lucifer, with Satan, and we join God's side. So we switch allegiances. We put down our rebel weapons and we join God's kingdom. We put on the tunic, we put on the belt, the helmet, the shield, the sword of God. But we have to put down our rebel weapons, our sins first. Okay? And then we go from being loyal to Satan, to this world, to being loyal to King Jesus Christ. And then we stay loyal to him all of our days. Loyalty is the key word here. Loyalty. We shift our loyalty from self, from what I want, to my own little life, to King Jesus Christ, a whole new situation. Okay? Let's reaffirm that. And if you want to give your life to Christ for the first time tonight, pray with me right now. Heavenly Father, we admit that we have sinned against you. We've had weapons of sin in our hands, and we've been rebels. Forgive us, Lord Jesus. We have sinned against you. Lord Jesus, we lay down our weapons of rebellion. We turn away from that life of rebellion, of worldliness, of selfishness. We turn to you, King Jesus Christ. We believe, Lord Jesus, that you were crucified for our sins, that you rose on the third day, and that you are alive and our leader and our King right now. We join up with you, Lord Jesus. We lay aside the ways of the world. Grant us the Holy Spirit to guide us in this new life as we put on your uniform, God, and we follow your ways. We commit our lives to you now, Lord Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.